me see that map. All right. So here's Akintal.
And as I remember, that should be on the left. And I don't remember.
It is. And here's Braymore.
Should be on the right.
It is. So where the hell are we?
What's in the middle?
Nothing.
That's where we are.
In nothing.
Yes. And for a man with my potentialities, this is the ideal location. We'll find our way out when the sun comes up.
A fine couple of game hunters we are. We come all the way out here from New York, and our first night out we get lost.
Well, maybe we should have took the high road instead of the low road. Would you like a drink?
No, thanks.
Good. More for me.
Didn't you tell me you were gonna cut back on that stuff?
Yes, I did. But I'm a terrible liar. Besides, it doesn't pay. I remember I was going with this wonderful girl who would plead with me and plead with me to give it up. So one day I did. Then we discovered we had nothing more to talk about, so we broke up.
You know, there's something about this forest that makes me feel like I'm in a cathedral.
Well, if we were, I'd know where the exit was.
You don't believe in anything, do you, Jeff?
Of course I do.
Really? What?
Practically anything I can understand. Anything that's real to me. Anything I can touch, taste, hear, see, smell, or swallow.
And what about the things you don't understand?
I dismiss them.
Well, that sounds very easy, doesn't it?
Comfortable is the word.
I envy you, Jeff.
Why?
You seem to be very satisfied.
Well, I am. Aren't you?
No, I'm not.
Well, that is the silliest thing I've ever heard. You've got a fine job. You're engaged to a fine girl. You're lost in a fine forest. What more could you want?
I don't know, but there's something wrong, especially about Jane and me. Look how I put off getting married. I just can't get myself to the altar.
Well, I don't know what could be wrong about it. She's young, attractive. She fits smack into your niche in life. And on top of that, she loves you. And just the proper amount, too.
What's the proper amount?
Enough to make you happy, but not enough to embarrass your friends.
Yeah, it seems ideal, doesn't it? Why don't I see it? I must be lacking somewhere.
Now, don't you go talking yourself into an inferiority. You don't deserve it.
What do you mean?
Well, most of my friends with inferiority complexes are exactly, absolutely right. They're not as good as everyone else. But someone like you, who, tall, dark.
Wait, listen. Do you hear that?
Yeah.
Look over there.
It's a village.
It is.
I thought you said there were no towns on the map around here.
Well, I did, but look, you see that strange fog all around the village?
But there's no mist in the valley.
Just around the little town. Well, it's not too far. Let's walk over to it. Come on.
Wait till Rand McNally hears about this.
Fair lady,
for sale or barter
there
at the
What? Come, Harry. Put down your book and help your father.
Well, sir.
You may even get to like the weaving business.
I'll never like the weaving business, Father. You know it well.
Try, lad. Tell Agnes McGuffey we need some eggs. I'll give her enough wool for a skirt, for enough eggs for our dinner. Good morning to ye, Mr. McLaren.
Good day, Archie.
And good morning to your two bonny daughters.
Good morning, Mr. Beaton.
And what would ye be looking for, Miss Fiona?
A waistcoat for my father for the wedding.
Why, of course. Ye and young Charlie Dalrymple are getting married this evening, aren't ye, Miss Jean?
Aye, Mr. Beaton.
Well, if you had to marry someone other than my son, Harry, I'm glad 'tis a lad as fine as Charlie.
Aye, Mr. Beaton.
Ye must be happy as a lark in the glen.
Aye, Mr. Beaton.
As you can see, Mr. Beaton, Jean is a wee bit short of words today.
Father says I shouldn't talk too much. He says when I speak, I sound so happy he finds it annoying.
Is that what ye said, Mr. McLaren?
Perhaps ye did. Besides, when a lass gets married, she must be used to listening and no talking.
I didn't think Charlie will have any trouble with Miss Jean here. She's a good maiden.
Archie, all maidens are good. Someone tell me where all the bad wives come from. Friends, Mr. Lundy has written upon this parchment a few reminders. He asked me to hang it in the public square where ye all can see it. And be reminded, aye?
Aye.
This is the second day of our blessing, and this is to remind ye of the obligations we all have so gratefully accepted, aye?
Aye.
And so I shall hang it in the square as I told Mr. Lundy.
Yet her father likes to take charge of things, doesn't he, Miss Fiona?
Aye, especially after everything's been done. Would you have a waistcoat of this that would fit him?
I think so, Miss Fiona.
Hello, Harry.
Hello, Jane.
How are you today?
How do you expect me to be? This is your wedding day, isn't it?
I'm truly sorry, Harry.
Dinna be. If anybody's going to pity me, let it be me. Trapped forever without ye in this peasant village.
What did Agnes say, Harry?
I forgot.
Hello, Harry.
Hello, Fiona. It just isn't fair for Charlie Dalrymple to be marrying Eugene. He's got everything. School in Edinburgh and now ye. And I've got nothing.
Harry, take this material to the house and see if there is a waistcoat of it there.
Nothing but to be doing this me whole life.
Hey, why didn't ye pay attention to Maggie Anderson? Ye know she has a yearning for ye.
Aye, Father.
Fiona, I feel so sorry for it. I know, darling. Mr. Beaton, you didn't hate me for not loving Harry, do ye?
No, Miss Jean, 'tis not your fault. I sometimes think the only woman who could have loved Harry was his mother, rest her soul.
Come, Jenny. Ye're going to spend the day with your father today. And Fiona.
Aye.
Make certain to buy everything that's needed for the wedding supper tonight, eh? Hey!
Yes, I will, Father.
And then just what's needed. My aim on this occasion is to be hospitable, no philanthropic. Come, Ginny.
You'll send the waistcoat to the house, Mr.
Beaton? Aye, Miss Fiona.
Thank you. Good morning, Meg.
Good morning, Fiona.
A jug of cream, please.
Oh, Miss McGuffey will be pleased. It's the last buy-in for a change.
Why?
Oh, well, when the lads come shopping, they look so handsome, I do nothing to ask them for money.
Oh, you'll never make a profit doing that.
No, but to make a lot of friends. Oh, is this for the wedding tonight?
Aye.
Oh, Fiona. When are you going to think about marriage for yourself?
Well, when I find someone who makes me think of it.
Oh, and you never found anyone up till now that makes you think of it?
No. You see, I didn't want to just get married. Oh. I think you should only do it when you and your lad want to stay together fiercely. Getting married is the only way to do it proper.
That's an unusual idea, Fiona.
Many a lassie, as everyone knows, will try to be married before. Setting ready for me.
when last he said, and have no men, oh, how long becomes the night. But I fear the night is longer, oh, let not run. Waiting for my day is sweeter.
Brigadoon listed on the map.
I shouldn't have been surprised.
You mean you know it isn't on the map?
Aye.
Well, that's a little snobbish of you, don't you think?
Why isn't it on the map?
For good and sound reasons.
Well, what are you all dressed up for? Is this the day you take pictures or postcards?
We're not dressed up.
You mean you always go around with all those clothes on?
No.
Okay, come on, somebody. What's going on here? What is this?
We're having a fair!
Oh, is that milk you're selling there?
Hi.
Can I buy some? I'm thirsty. We've been walking all night.
I'll have to see your money first.
All right.
Would you give her a hunk of uranium?
Just a shilling. What a loony layout this is.
It's very interesting, sir, but it does me no good.
What do you mean it does you no good? Sell me something and it will.
I cannot sell you anything, but if you're thirsty, I'll give you some milk.
Never mind, I don't want any favors.
Oh, I see from your coin you're from England.
No, we're from America.
Oh, you're Americans.
I am. He's from Wisconsin. Come on, boy.
No, wait, please. We didn't mean to act so strangely. We're just a wee bit taken aback. People didn't come here very often.
See why you're taken aback. You act like we've just dropped in from another world. Does that amuse you?
Very much, because...
Quiet!
Must be the daughter of two first cousins.
If you've been traveling all night, you must be very tired and hungry. Wouldn't you like a place to lie down and rest before you start back?
That'd be very nice, thank you.
Good. I'm Fiona McLaren.
I'm Tommy. Albright. Oh, and this is Jeff Douglas.
How do you do, sir?
And I'm Meg Brocky.
I'm glad you're happy about it.
There's a tavern on the next street where you can get some food.
Oh, I'll take you.
Wait.
Go on ahead, Jeff. I'll call
me
in first.
Is Miss Meg going to be taking care of you, sir?
I think so. Why?
Well, I have some plaid trousers here. And after you leave the tavern, if Miss Meg should take you somewhere to rest, and you should happen to rip your own on a thistle, I'd be more than happy to replace them for you.
Thanks, old man, but I don't expect to get stuck.
You do not know it, laddie, but you're stuck now.
Tend to your sailing, Mr. Peyton.
What a place. Say, is there a phone around here I can use?
A phone?
Yes.
Why did I think we have one?
No phone?
No, sir.
Tell me, what's so strange about this place?
Nothing, sir. You're the one who's strange.
Hi, Charlie. Here's a bottle of claret. Come have a drama good luck with me.
Ah, the merry bridegroom himself.
Good morning, darling.
Bridegroom?
Aye, he's marrying my sister this evening.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Charlie, this is Tommy Albright. He just happened in a few moments ago.
Really? Of course. Welcome to you, sir.
Thanks. Welcome to you.
Here's your dram, Charlie. Oh,
thank you, Agnes.
And you, sir.
Oh, yes, thank you.
I think I'll drink this one to you, Mr. Forsyth. I just hope he knows how grateful I am to him for postponing the miracle for me.
The what?
And may God bless me this evening, as much as I would bless him, if I were he, and he were Charles Dalrymple.
What did you say about postponing a miracle?
'Tis a toast we have here, sir.
Take it down, I'll explain it to you sometime.
Say, that's wonderful. May I have another?
That was a wedding gesture, sir. From now on, it's for sale only.
I've got vice of claret and ale for supper. Come with me and you can have some more.
Oh, fine.
Willens, plaids.
Is an odd one, isn't he?
Aye, and a peculiar accent.
I wonder what American women must be like.
I do not wonder about women anymore, Agnes. I'm not allowed to.
That's right, Charlie. You're through with the lasses for good, aren't you?
I used to be a roving lad, a roving and wandering life I had. On any lass I'd frown, who would try to tie me down? Now at last I found a maid who held out her hand, and I stayed and stayed. And now across the green, I'll go home with Bonnie Jean.
Go home, go home, go home with Bonnie Jean. Go home, go home,
I'll go home with Bonnie Jean. I used to have 100 friends, but when they're ordered, the friendship ends. They'll never come to call, so farewell to and all. Farewell to all the lads I knew. I'll see them again when they're married too. For soon across the green I'll go home with Bonnie Jean.
Go home, go home, go home with Bonnie Jean. Go home, go home,
I'll go home with Bonnie Jean. In Edinburgh I used to know a lass with an air and her name was Jo. And every night at 10 I would meet her in the glen. But now I'll not see her again, especially not in the glen at 10. For now across the green I'll go home with Bonnie Jean.
Go home, go home, go home.
For now across the green.
Wonderfully refreshing to see a young fellow so enthusiastic about getting married.
Is it so unusual?
I think it is. Look at me, I'm not bubbling over like Charlie. Next month I'm facing the minister.
You're getting married?
Yes.
Oh.
Oh, what?
I'm just a wee bit surprised. Somehow you didn't seem like the sort of lad who would want to settle down.
Oh, I didn't say that. I just said I was getting married.
Well, if you feel that way about it, why are you?
Because the woman wants to.
Is that reason enough?
I think so. I don't know how it is in the Highlands, but in my neighborhood, if you've been going with a woman long enough and she decides she wants to get married, you better do it right away and save yourself a lot of trouble.
Why?
Because she'll either torment you so that you marry her for relief, or she'll be so sweet about it that you'll feel guilty and your conscience will make you do it.
Mm. I must say, it didn't sound like you love her very much.
It doesn't, does it?
And it also sounds like a very peculiar land you come from.
Well, listen to me, lass. This isn't the normal hamlet off the highway either. Say, what was that business about Charlie and the man postponing a miracle?
Oh, that. I'm sorry, I cannot say.
But you said you'd tell me later.
I know. But I cannot say.
That's fine. You know, I think if I stick around this place long enough, I may find that everyone here is slightly nutty. Is that possible?
I cannot say.
Why?
Because I didn't know what nutty means.
It means slightly insane.
Well, then, I can assure you that we are all far from insane. We are the most blessed group of people, and I never realized how fortunate we are until I meet someone from the outside. I mean, a stranger to Brigadoon. I didn't know anything about you, but from the little that you've said, everything you think, I think differently about. And I'm also quite certain that everything I think is much more pleasant. Now, sorry I said all that, but you angered me when you called us insane.
Say, you don't like me very much, do you?
Well, that's the odd part. I like you very much. I just didn't like anything you say.
Fiona.
I...
If I were to stick around here today, would you take me to the wedding with you tonight?
Why would you suddenly want to go?
I cannot say.
Well, then I'll take you, and I'll be highly glad that you'll be there.
Oh, you will? Why is that?
Well, because of what I just told you. I like you very much.
That's right. You did say that, didn't you?
Now come with me, and I'll show you a place you can lie down and rest.
Oh, well, what are you going to do?
I'm going to gather heather for the wedding.
Where are you going to do that?
On the hill, where the heather is.
May I come with you?
No, I'll do it much faster alone, thank you.
Come on, I won't be any bother. Maybe I'm the one who's slightly nutty, but... Can't we two go walking together out beyond the valley of trees? Out where there's a hillside of heather, curtsying gently in the breeze. That's what I'd like to do, see the heather, but with you. The mist of May is in the gloaming, and all the clouds are holding still. So take my hand and let's go roaming through the heather on the hill. The morning dew is blinking yonder. There's lazy music in the rain. And all I want to do is wander through the heather on the hill. There may be other days as rich and rare. There may be other springs as full and fair, but they won't be the same. They'll come and go, for this I know, that when the mist is in the gloaming and all the clouds are holding still, if you're not there I won't go roaming through the heather on the hill.
You see, you can say nice things when you want to. Or are you just being sentimental because you're tired?
Oh, is that what I'm being? Sentimental because I'm tired?
I believe so. But it is very agreeable.
Maze in the gloaming, and all the clouds are holding still. So take my hand and let's go roaming through the heaven on the hill. The morning dew is blinking yonder, there's lazy music in the air, and 'tis a lovely
picturesque view of the glen.
Thank you.
What for?
Why, for liking when I brought you. It makes me very happy.
You get happy very easily, don't you? Well, I haven't been in an open shed like this since I was a boy, which, at this point, seems like a good 2,000 years ago.
You mean you're tired?
Aye, lassie, I'm tired. That's why you brought me here, isn't it? To take a nap?
I shouldn't think a long walk would fatigue a young laddie like you.
Young lad?
Aye, very young.
That is either a deliberate lie or wishful thinking. I am ancient, decrepit, and disintegrating rapidly.
Aye.
What's under here, a rock garden?
My father used to sleep on it.
That was his second mistake.
He and my mother met in the shed. You see, my mother was a gypsy.
You don't say.
Aye. And one day, she was walking by the shed, saw my father asleep on the cot. She liked his looks and was a wee bit tired anyhow. So she took off her shoes, sat in the rocking chair and waited for him to wake up. It wasn't long after that I was born.
What a sweetest bedtime story I've ever heard.
Are you sure you're comfortable?
Very. Thank you very much. You've been more than kind. Now, if you want to round out your generosity, say goodnight.
I just hate to leave you. Can't you see I'm highly attracted to ye?
Thank you very much. And when I wake up, we'll discuss the whole problem. And believe me, you've got a problem.
Oh, but when I see you lying on the cot, I get little tadpoles jumping up and down my spine.
Oh, that is about as revolting an idea as I've ever heard.
No, but I've been waiting for so long.
You certainly have one hell of an imagination.
No.
Can you give me one good reason why I, a strange man, would be interested in you, a strange woman, and at this hour of the day?
Well, of course I can.
Because you're a lad and I'm a lass.
Well, with that philosophy, you must have had a very provocative career.
Oh, I've had a great many heartbreaks.
Don't doubt that at all.
At 16 years, I was blue and sad. Then father said I should find a lad. So out I went to become a wife and find the real love of my life. His name, it was Chris, and the last was McGill. I met him one night, picking flowers on the hill. He had lots of charm and a certain kind of touch and a certain kind of eagerness that pleased me very much. So there beneath the moon, where romance often springs, I gave him my heart and a few other things. I don't know how long that I stayed upon that hill, but the moon had disappeared and so had Christopher McGill. So I went home and I thought I'd die, till father said, make another try. So out I went to become a wife and find the real love of my life. He came from the lowlands of you. I saw him and knew he was perfect for me. Just one thing that puzzled me, and it always will, was he told me he had heard about me from his friend McGill. We quick fell in love and went down by the creek. The next day he said he'd be back in a week. And I thought he would, now for how was I to know that of all the lowland laddies, there was never one as low. I told my father the awful truth. He said, what difference you got your youth? So out I went mad to be a wife and find the real love of my life. Oh, he was a poet, a rhymer was he. He read me some verse he had written for me. He said they would move me, these poems from his pen, and how right he was
because they moved me right into the glen. We stayed till the dawn came and lighted the sky. Then I shook his hand and I bid him goodbye. I never went back, for what I had heard was true, that a poet only writes about the things he cannot do. My pa said, look out for men who think. You'll be more certain with men who drink. So out I went to become a wife and find the real love of my life. Oh, he was a soldier, a fine Highland son. He told me about all the battles he'd won. He wasted his time telling me about his might, for one look at him decided he did not put up a fight. We skirmished for hours the night in the wood, and I found the sword had more might than the pen. But when I was rousing, I snored to my dismay, and he thought it was a duel and got up and marched away. Now Pa says, daughter, there must be one, someone who's true or too old to run. So I'm still looking to be a wife, find the real love of my life.
Mr. McLaren, I've got your waistcoat.
Thank you, Harry. It is good to see you. Wait a minute, lad.
What for?
Why at dinner you take my hand? I'm not your enemy.
Ye may not mean to be, but ye are. And so is everyone else in this town.
What is it, lad? Why do you go about hating everybody?
I couldn't get through this day of seeing her marry someone else if I didn't. What can I do? What could anyone do when you realize that your life didn't mean a damn? I cannot leave here. I cannot go to university and make something of myself. And I cannot have Jean. So there's nothing left to do but to hate everything and everyone in this cursed time.
You'll never find any peace by hating, lad. It'll only cut you off from the rest of the world. Besides, this is only a cursed town if you make it so. For the rest of us, this is a blessed place.
Well, you can keep it.
All right, I'm done. Who was that?
My waistcoat came.
Oh.
Nicolaine.
Jeannie.
Charlie, please go away. I want to come out.
Then I'll listen to her, lad. You'll just spoil her.
Oh.
Yeah. I can hardly wait for the wedding.
Jeannie.
Charlie, please go away.
Because they told me I can't be moldy till wedding music starts playing. To ease my longing, there's nothing wrong in me standing out here and saying, come to me and kiss me.
my longing. There's nothing wrong in me standing out here and saying, come to me and kiss me good day. Darling, my darling, 'tis all I can say. Just
good morning, laddie.
Hi. Where have you been?
Nice place you got here. You should have seen the apartment I got, complete with built-in lassie. And you can forget all that rubbish about Scottish frugality. The generosity is overpowering.
But how do you feel?
Surprisingly well. How about you?
I've never felt better in all my life.
You too?
Maybe the sun gave me the power, for I could swim Loch Lomond and be home in half an hour. Maybe the air gave me the drive, for I'm all aglow and alive. What a day this has been, what a rare mood I'm in. Why, it's almost like
I could swear I was falling. It's almost like me.
right, darling.
Darling?
Thank you, dearie.
Well, when do we start back?
Oh, come on, there's no rush. Let's stay for the wedding. After all, how often do you...
What's the matter?
I must be a little touched. Listen to this. Married Elizabeth Lang to Andrew McLaren, July 7th, 1719.
What's so amazing? People used to get married back then.
Wait a minute. Children. Fiona, born June 14th, 1722. Jean, born April 8th, 1728.
Well?
But Fiona's 24. She's got a sister 6 years younger named Jean.
Well?
Those are the two sisters in this Bible.
That's ridiculous. They're probably just named after them.
Jean's getting married today. Did you know that?
Yes.
Do you know the name of the fella she's marrying?
Well, he told me down in the tavern. Some guy named Dalrymple.
Well, get this. Married Jean McLaren to Charles McPherson Dalrymple, May 24th, 1746. Now, what do you say to that?
Congratulations.
No Brigadoon on the map. No phones in the whole town. Thanks to Mr. Somebody about doing something about a miracle. I've just had the most wonderful day of my life, and now I come across something like this. It doesn't make any sense. Well, there's got to be a logical explanation, even logical enough for you.
Well, you don't have to explain it to me. I don't care.
Fiona.
What is it, Tommy?
Come here.
Tommy, what's wrong?
Is this your name here in this Bible?
Hi, I'm...
Someone seems to have loused up your books.
Well, come on. What does it mean? Is there an explanation or isn't there?
Aye, there is. But I cannot tell you.
Well, is there someone who can? I'd like to know.
You'd have to speak to the dominie.
The who?
Our schoolmaster, Mr. Lundy.
Well, where does he live?
Down the road, in a tree.
He doesn't live in a tree, Mr. Douglas. Mr. Lundy is a fine man. All right, Tommy, I'll take you to him. I hadn't wanted to because... I was hoping we could spend the day together.
What's that got anything to do with it?
It's going to be so hard for you to believe what you'll hear. You'll think there's something wrong with us and you'll leave. I know it.
Maybe I will and maybe I won't. Come on, Jeff.
Is it informal or should I wear my three-corn hat?
Come on, I said. Talking about you, Jeff.
And I. Now, supposing an outsider were to come upon the town of Brigadoon and to hear the tale of the miracle come from the lips from someone in the town, well, he would think that Lass or Lad was daft. And that would lead to a lot of unpleasant and, well, humiliating things for that Lass and Laddie, now wouldn't it?
I suppose so.
I suppose so. So only I can talk about the miracle. Strangers.
And you don't imagine that anybody would think you're crazy.
Oh, you may very well, but it wouldn't have hurt me. I just did it. Now, the miracle began, what's today?
Friday.
That means it happened exactly 200 years ago. 200 years ago, the Highlands of Scotland were plagued with witches, wicked sorcerers, who had taken the Scottish folk away from the teachings of God and put the devil into their souls. Now, here in Brigadoon, we had an old minister of the kirk by the name of Mr. Forsyth, and a good man he was.
The kindest man in all of Scotland.
I believe he was. No man ever loved his parish as much as Mr. Forsyth. But he was a growing old, and it grieved him to know that someday soon he would have to leave all those he held dear. But most of all, he worried about the witches. Now, they hadn't come to Brigadoon yet, but he knew that there was a band of them coming our way.
A
and he began to wonder if there was something that he could do to, well, protect the people of his parish, not only from them, but from all the evils that would come to Brigadoon from the outside world after he died.
What a kind man.
Oh, for many days he walked through the glen, thinking. And if you happened to come upon his house at any hour of the night, you'd see the candles lit and Mr. Forsyth sitting in his chair, thinking. And then one day he came to me and told me that he decided to ask God for a miracle.
His heart is so nice, I could cry thinking about it.
You see, he consulted with me because he knew I had a highly logical mind. And he figured if he was going to ask for a miracle, it might as well be a well-organized one. And so for many days we walked through the glen. And for many nights I sat up with him, sitting there by candlelight. And then, one day, Mr. Forsyth decided what he was going to pray for. And on a Wednesday morning, just after midnight, Mr. Forsyth went out to a hill beyond Brigadoon and made his prayer to God. There, in the hush of a sleeping world, he asked God to make Brigadoon and all the people in it vanish into the highland mist. Vanish. But not for always. He would come back just as it were, one day every 100 years. The people would live their customary lives, but when they would awaken the next morning, it would be 100 years later. And the next day, when we awoke, it was 100 years later.
My God.
You see, Mr. Forsyth figured that there would be no change in the lives of the people. They just wouldn't be in any century long enough for them to be touched by it.
So let me get this straight. Every night when you go to sleep and you wake up the next morning, it's 100 years later?
Aye.
Then every day is 100 years later?
Aye.
Well, what happened to the minister?
We never saw him again. You see, to ask for such a miracle, he realized that it would require a huge sacrifice, and he wanted to be the one to do it. Now, what greater sacrifice could he make but to be separated of all his time from all those that he loved so dear? And that's why he went to a hill beyond Brigadoon, where the miracle granted, he would never see Brigadoon again.
So, say for instance, somebody gets fed up and wants to leave Brigadoon. Can he?
No, he cannot leave.
You mean I've got to stay here now?
No, no, lad. According to Mr. Forsyth's contract with God, if anyone of Brigadoon should leave, then the enchantment is broken for all.
And?
That night, when everyone goes to sleep, Brigadoon will disappear forever.
Look, I'm not saying I believe in any of this, but just for argument's sake, what if a stranger like, well, me, came to Brigadoon and wanted to stay? Could he?
He can. Mr. Forsyth provided for that.
He didn't miss a trick, did he?
No, he didn't. A stranger can stay if he loved someone. Not just a Brigadoon, mind me, but someone of Brigadoon enough to want to give up everything and stay with that one person. Which is as it should be. For if you love someone deeply, anything is possible.
I think I like that part the best.
Should you be getting ready for the wedding?
I had. Tommy, will I see you later?
Yes, I'll be here.
Thank you, Tommy.
I think I want to stick around and see if this place evaporates like you say.
Well, I must be off, but thank you, Mr. Lundy.
She's a dear lass.
Finding that out. Tell me, Mr. Lundy, you're all perfectly happy living here in this little village?
Of course, lad. Sunshine can peep through a small hole.
But at night, when you go to sleep, what's it like?
Well, for me, it's like being carried in shadowy arms until I'm going to a dark cloud, and there I float until morning. But then I hear strange voices.
Voices?
But they don't say anything that I can remember. but they're filled with a fearful longing. During the day, I think about them, and I think that maybe they're from the outside world. Surely there must be a lot of people who like a Brigadoon. It's the wedding time!
Thanks to heaven.
Dorothy. There's no need for grieving now. Come, let's go back to the wedding supper.
He didn't get away, Mr. McLaren?
No, Aunt Jane.
Then where is my son? I want to see him. I thank God that you stopped him from his terrible intentions, but I want to see him.
It's all right, Archie. He's in good hands. Besides, it's best the lad be left alone for a while. Come, join us for a bit of supper.
I'm too ashamed for him, Mr. McLaren. I cannot join you.
But Archie. Come, everybody. Back to the glen for some food and ale. The alarm is over. Come, Fiona.
Have you seen Tommy?
The American Fiona?
Why, no. I didn't think he came back with us.
Fiona!
Tommy! I thought you had gone.
No, I didn't go. I couldn't.
And you're all right?
Of course I'm all right.
Thank heaven. I'd have died if anything had happened to you. I love you so.
You?
Aye.
But how can you know after just one day?
I don't know. It's just when a lass falls in or out of love, she knows it right away.
I wish my feelings were that clear to me.
What? Why?
Because I have a feeling I'm hearing my own secret being told.
You mean you think you're in love with me?
Think? What good does thinking do? If I thought about it, it wouldn't make any more sense than the miracle. But what I feel is something else.
Well, what do you feel then, Tommy?
This is hard to say, but as I wandered through the lea, I felt for just a fleeting moment that I suddenly was free of being lonely. Then I closed my eyes and saw the very reason why. I saw
that was all his own.
Tommy.
Jeff. I'm not going back with you.
Just for the record, what are you talking about?
I'm staying here.
Are you pulling my Bonnie leg?
No. I've never been more serious in all my life. I tell you, Jeff, just one day and I feel more connected to her and this place than I ever did about Jane or anyone back home.
My dear boy, it's only been one day. Don't you realize that if you stay here, it's for always?
I know.
And do you know how long always is around here? It's one hell of a long time.
I know.
Tommy, this can't be a trial marriage. You can't change your mind after trying it out for 600 or 700 years.
I won't ever want to.
You're absolutely positive that there will never come a time when you miss your family, your friends, the life that belongs to you. How can you know that now?
Well, this is where I know you'll think I'm crazy, but because I believe in her. And what's more, I believe in this place.
You do not. You just want to. This Highland voodoo town makes no more sense to you than it does to me. And how can you believe it if you don't even understand it? Now, when you leave here, in a few weeks, or even a few days, you'll forget all about it. You won't feel a thing. That's the way a dream is.
But what do you mean, dream?
Well, that's what this is, a dream. Even now, you're not really moved by it. You just think you are.
Okay, how do you know?
Because I do. Did you see that funeral here a moment ago?
Yes, why?
I'm responsible for it.
What are you talking about?
Harry Beaton. I killed him.
You did what?
I killed him. Accidentally, of course, but nevertheless, I killed him. Out in the forest, I suddenly saw him rushing past me from behind a bush without even really thinking about it. I stuck my foot out and down he went. And then I heard his head hit a rock with a very nasty thud.
God, Jeff, I'm so sorry.
What for?
You must feel half dead inside.
On the contrary, I don't feel a thing.
Actually don't feel anything?
Nothing. Except like going home.
But why don't you?
Because this is a dream. A good one for you and a bad one for
me. Stop it. Wait a minute, will you?
You see? I've confused you, haven't I?
Yes, you have.
Well, I couldn't do that if you really believed it as much as you say you do. I'll wait for you outside the town.
What did he mean by that, Tommy?
Fiona tells me you want to stay there.
It's no good, Fiona. I'm leaving. And it isn't because I don't love you. I think I do. I guess I don't trust my own feelings.
You mean you can't accept everything?
That's about it, I guess.
Fiona, you better hurry. You didn't have much time. You didn't have to be a feel ashamed, Tommy. It's hard to give up everything, even if that's the only way to get everything.
Do you understand at all?
See you, I'll be dreaming of.
just a prayer that someday when I should love, you'll find something from your heart has gone, gone with me from this day.
See, you mustn't be sorry about anything. It'll fade in time.
But when I do that,
Hello, Frankie.
Hey, well, you've been for the past
talking about, Tommy?
Up on a farm in New Hampshire.
A farm? Messing around in all that dirty dirt and everything? What have you been doing there?
Enjoying myself. Ryan soda, Frankie, please.
Well, if that's what you like, you get married. You should buy one.
I'm not sure I want to get married, Jeff.
Why?
Because, my dear old tank, I'm in love with someone else. And I cannot get over it.
Oh.
The thing is, because I can't be with her, I can't be with anyone else. That's why I went away. So many things remind me of her. I'll be talking with someone. They'll say one little word, and that'll open up a door to a memory of her. And I don't hear them anymore. I'm a few thousand miles away with her. And I slowly drift back to the conversation. They ask me a question, and I don't know what the hell they're talking about. I haven't heard a word.
You must be fascinating company.
When I'm alone, it's easier.
Tommy?
Jane!
Oh, what a wonderful surprise!
Hello, Jane!
When did you get back?
Hello, Jeff!
A little while ago.
How have you been, Jane?
I must say I've been worried to death about you.
Fine, Jeff, how are you?
Let me look at you.
Well, I've had a little bit of a cold, but other than that...
I must say you do look wonderful.
So do you, Jane.
Well, I hate to eat and run, so I think I'll go up to my room and have a drink.
I'll see you later, Jeff.
Hello.
Goodbye. Put it on my bill, Frankie!
Your bill, sir, is awfully high.
So am I.
Tommy, when did you get back? Why didn't you write me?
Nothing to say, I guess. Drink?
Old-fashioned, please. And why didn't you wire me you were coming in? After all, I did think the minute you get in town, you would call me or come to me.
Come to me.
Oh. Who's he?
I just told you. He's the real estate man I've been working with. I told him you'd call him.
I can hardly wait.
Please do. I've been trying so hard to arrange everything. Do you still want Jeff to stand up for you?
Yes. If he can. Why?
Nothing. It's just... he's so impossible these days. Everyone's bored to death with him.
I don't care about everyone, especially the everyone we know.
You've certainly been antisocial since you've returned from Scotland. If you really want to avoid everybody, why don't we take Mr. Jackson's house? It's far away and right on top of a high, beautiful hill.
Calling it off for good.
Calling it off?
I can't do it, ever.
You have a nerve. After all this time, I've waited for you and tried to be patient with you and put up with your idiotic whims and temperament.
I'm sorry, it's not your fault. You've been wonderfully kind to me. It's just Something happened a couple months ago that I can't explain, and now I don't fit in anywhere.
I think you're going clean out of your mind, but I refuse to stand here and argue with you in this bar. Let's go home.
Go home, go home, go home with Bonnie Jean. Go home, go home.
Raving mad, so think that over, Mr. Albright, when you're all alone.
I think real loneliness is not being in love in vain, but not being in love at all.
You understood, Fiona. I didn't. Between the mist and the stars, there's someone I want so desperately. She's not dead, she's just asleep, and I know I'll never see her again.
Did you bring me all the way out here to tell me that? You could have told me that over the phone. In New York. For a nickel.
No, I'll tell you why. She became so real to me that I had to come out here myself and see the place wasn't really there.
It didn't work that way for me. So much like a dream to me now that I have to work hard just to convince myself that it happened at all.
That's the big difference between us.
Yeah. Tell me about it.
I found that sometimes the things you believe in become more real to you than anything you can explain away or understand. Why does someone have to lose something to know what it means to them?
Take one last look, and then we'll start walking back. I got lost around here once.
Okay.
Tommy, lad! My, you must really love her. You woke me up! Come, lad! Oh, didn't be so surprised. Didn't I tell you, if you love someone deeply, anything is possible, even miracles.
Thank you.